good morning to my brothers and sisters. Now that sounds like you are feeling like it is outside. So let's try this again. Good morning to my brothers and sisters.
Good morning.
Today's Sabbath, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, which means it's a joyful day. I mean, especially for the women. You know, I love Sabbath because on Sabbath day, I don't have to cook, I don't have to clean, I don't have to wash clothes, I don't have to... It's a day of true rest and joy.
Sorry. But I'm sorry, but I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
I bring you greetings from the President of the World Church, Elder Ted
Wilson.
And he always asks me to ask the women of the church. He wants us to do two things for him. To look after the visitors who come to church. And to look after the new members in church. Because we are nurturers, caregivers. And he knows that we can love them and we can nurture them and keep them. I also bring you greetings from your 10 million sisters around the world church. And I want you to know that even though our languages are different, even though we may look different, even though we may eat different foods, we are all the same. We cry the same, we laugh the same. We love our families. We pray for our children, our husbands the same way. So when you pray for yourselves, remember your sisters in the world church. It is a joy for me to be here in Tonga. This is my first visit. And I'm enjoying it immensely. From here, I go to Fiji. And Fiji is going to have a difficult time trying to reach up to what Tonga has done. Because I have been loved, I have been fed and cared for. And I've received many hugs. So Pastor Nasoli, send a text message and let them know. Get ready. This morning I want to share with you one of the topics that I believe we all need to hear from time to time. It's titled, God Can When You Cannot. Let's pray.
Hello.
Father, we have one request today. We ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit on each person here, each man, each woman, each boy, each girl. We need you, Lord, to fix us. We're not perfect and we know it. But we want the message today to change something in our lives, to give us the encouragement that we need, to help us to hold on to you. Even when the storms are raging around us, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for what you will do today. and we give you praise in advance of what you are going to do, and much thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I love to study the names of God. Because I find the names of God help me understand who God is. You know, one of my favorite Bible texts is Philippians
4:13.
I think everyone knows it. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And out of this text, I have developed a motto for my life every day. And the motto is, there's nothing God and I can't do. No matter how bad the day is going, no matter how many problems I have to face, no matter if I'm feeling weak, I say this to myself. There's nothing God and I can't do. You know, God calls each of us to work for Him. To reach our world for Him. But it's not easy when we have so many problems and trials dealing with. And so we need to know, how do I keep my joy? How do I reach my world for Jesus? When life is going a little rocky. When things aren't always what I want them to be. And that's where the names of God come in. And I'm sure you know some of these names. Jehovah Shalom, God is peace. Jehovah Nissi, his banner over me is love. But one of my favorite names for God is El Shaddai. El Shaddai means the Almighty God. This is the God who can do anything. Nothing is impossible for the El Shaddai. And El Shaddai is the Hebrew name given for God. So I want us to think about this name as we go through the sermon. And I want you to open your Bibles to Mark chapter 4. Verse
35.
And I want us to read together, everyone read out loud, verse 35 to 41. Mark chapter 4, verse 35. When you find it, say Amen.
Amen.
And so my sister will lead out in the reading, but I want us all to read as well, together. Then I am a father, Now this is a story that I know we've heard many times before. But I want us to take a different look at this story. And I want us to understand what's taking place here. Jesus had been preaching all day long. He had preached about the parable of the sower and the seed. He spent time with his disciples explaining what he was teaching. And it seems from this chapter that he had been preaching all day long. He talked about not to hide your light under a basket. The parable of the mustard seed. And then the day comes to the end. And he's tired. And the Bible tells us that he says to his disciples, let us cross over. So they're going one from one side over to the other side. But when I read God's word, I like to highlight the words that speak to my heart. And as I highlight those words, I apply it to my life. First, I read it through so I understand what the story is telling me. And then I go back verse by verse. And this is what I found as I went through these verses. Let us cross over. Jesus gave his disciples an invitation. He didn't ask them to go on their own. He said, let us. He was inviting them to journey with him. And all his disciples had to do was say, yes, let's go. You know, Jesus gives each of us this invitation every day. He says, let us go through this day together. He never sends us on our own. He wants to be with us. And he says, to the other side. What does he mean by to the other side? He didn't really explain exactly where the other side was. Now, let's be honest. Wouldn't we love if Jesus would tell us where we were going? If he could tell us, well, next week you're going to be in this problem, and the week after you'll be in that problem. If only we could know the map that Jesus is taking our lives on. But he doesn't do that. He says, let us cross over to the other side. Now, as Christians, we all know that the other side for us is going to be heaven. That's our goal. But how are we getting there? We don't know. What are the troubles and trials that we will meet, we don't know. But we do know that Jesus says he'll go with us. Verse 36, it says he left the multitude. You know, when we think of a life with Jesus, there are some things we have to leave behind. I'll be honest with you, when I travel from my home, and I live in Washington, D.C., when I leave my home to come on a trip, there are certain things I wish I could bring with me. I wish I could bring my bed. Because my bed fits my body. I wish I could bring my husband. I wish I could bring my refrigerator. Because it has all the stuff in it that I like to eat. But I can't bring those things with me. I have to leave them behind. And when we take our journey with Jesus, there are some things that we have to leave behind. Sometimes it's places that we like to go. Sometimes we have to leave friends behind. Friends who want to lead us in the wrong way. Whatever it is, if you're going to be successful in this journey, you've got to leave it behind. If they had taken the multitude into the boat would have done what? It would sink. And some of the things that we are holding on to will cause us to sink. So we have to learn to let them go. So then Jesus says, the Bible says, he left the multitude. And I love these three words in verse 36. Mark says, they took him along. Three words, took him along. You know, Jesus asks us to journey with him. He said, let us go through this day. You don't know what the day holds, but God knows. But he doesn't force himself into our lives. Have you ever seen the picture of Jesus knocking on the door? And the door is supposed to represent our heart. And the picture shows Jesus standing at the door knocking. But have you ever noticed there is no handle on the door? In other words, Jesus doesn't open it and walk inside. It's up to us to open the door and let him in. He doesn't force his way into our lives. He doesn't try to make us do things. He says, let us. And then we have to take him along. We have to be sure that he's in the boat. Every morning when we wake up, Jesus is standing saying, let us. And unless we take the time to meet with him, we journey the day on our own. We must take the time to to take him with us. Verse 37 says, a great windstorm arose. Were the disciples ready to deal with the storm? Are you ready to deal with your storms? You know, you can be going through life very calmly. And all of a sudden a storm will hit you. No warning. The storm just comes. You know, many years ago, on a Sunday morning, this was 1985, my husband and I had been married just about 6 years. We had two children, a little boy called Joseph, after his dad. And we call him Joey. And a little girl called
Delon.
Joey was 4, Delon was 2. In those days, we lived in our home island of Trinidad and Tobago. Very much like your island, same. Same fruit, same plant, same vegetable, same. We had just had breakfast. My husband and I were living at my father's home. Because we had just come back from studying in the States. And we were looking for jobs and for a house. And so we were in one part of the home. And so I had made breakfast and we had sat and eaten, and my husband was going to mow the grass for my flowers. And Joey said, me too, Daddy, me too. So they went outside. I was in the kitchen. My daughter was playing with the pots and pans. And I was washing up the dishes after we had eaten. Now my father had two dogs. They were Doberman dogs. Big and black. But they were very nice dogs. One male, one female. So I'm standing there washing dishes. And all of a sudden, I hear this growling. And then I hear my husband shouting. And I go to the door of the kitchen. And I look outside. And one of the dogs has my son by his head on the ground. And he was shaking by the head. And my husband was shouting and he came to where the dog was. And he kicked the dog in his side. And the dog let go of my son's head. And he ran behind my husband. And he came around on the other side and he grabbed my son by the other side of his head. And then my husband kicked the dog very hard. And the dog ran away. We rushed my son to the hospital. He had a big scar here that was opened and another one here. And he was bleeding from his head. And I remember holding the bag with the ice on his head in the car.
woman to be then now for I see that I'm going to
and I was singing to him all the little Sabbath school songs he knew. Tako hina hina
pete kita masi epa kini hina la pete fasaba go da bene.
Just to keep him calm.
Go hi pete ta hi ke meli no pe
mo. We got to the hospital.
Ma o ke kifar mahati.
And I remember they put him on the bed.
Koman tu bene na wa fato de nona.
And the doctor asked me to hold his head.
Tako kor ma to kita ta ke pete pete mo ano.
He was moving. So I sat on a stool and I was holding his head. And I remember the blood was just coming down my arms onto the ground. And I kept singing and singing. And he was very calm. And then the doctor said, we need to take him to we need to put him to sleep. Because he was still shifting too much. And so they gave him an injection. And he relaxed.
Yeah.
And I went to wash my hands. And all of a sudden I heard the nurse say, doctor, he's not breathing. And I heard my husband say, what? And he rushed into the room. And he grabbed my son by his feet. And he
handed him
out. And the milk and the cereal he had that morning was coming out of his mouth. You see, they had put him to sleep, but they didn't ask me if he had eaten. Because when you are sleeping, your muscles relax. And the food from his stomach was coming up and had gone into his lungs. So they rushed him into the surgery. And they rushed him into the surgery. Our family doctor was there. And he would go into the surgery and come and tell us how things
will
go.
And
every 5 minutes or so, he'd come and say, everything's fine. And we were in an empty room in the hospital. And we were in an empty room in the hospital. And my husband was kneeling by the bed. And he was God. Don't take my son. Take me, I'm sinful. But let my son live. And I was walking up and down in the room praying. And the doctor would come and say, everything's okay. And after about 5 minutes passed, 6 minutes passed. And my heart began to sink. And I thought, something's going on. And finally the doctor came. And he looked at me. And he said, I'm sorry, but Joey died. Did I expect it? Did I know that was going to happen? It was a regular day for us. A day that we would have spent with the kids playing and me doing some housework. But a great windstorm arose. And I'm going to tell you, Jesus wasn't in my boat. Life had become too busy. I had been spending time with my morning worship every day. And like most of us do, we only talk to God when the problems come. And And so my boat was
sinking.
The only way I made it through the next week was with God's help. Because no one knows when the windstorm is going to come. But one thing we do know, it will come. No matter what it is, it will come. Because we live in a sinful world. And bad things will happen to good people. But you know what I learned? Bad things happen to bad people. As a matter of fact, Satan does not discriminate. He brings trials to everyone in this world. But the difference for the Christian, the difference for the person who has Jesus in their boat, is the hope that he gives us of heaven to come. The person who doesn't know Jesus begins to sink and will drown eternally. But the person who knows Jesus will survive the storm. And so verse 38 says, but he was in the boat. Those are words of encouragement. That in the storm, you know Jesus is in the boat. Sometimes we forget he's in the boat. And like the disciples, when the storm comes, we struggle trying to fix it. And we try all sorts of different things. And it doesn't make any difference. And then we remember, but Jesus is in the boat. And that's what Jesus wants us to remember first. When the storm comes, look to Jesus first. Don't pick up the phone and tell someone, oh, this is so terrible. Don't run around trying to see what you will do. Don't let your blood pressure go up. Jesus first. And the Bible says that when he stood up and said, peace be still, the storm was over. You see, that's what we need to remember. That Jesus is in the boat. You know, there's one thing I learned. Have you ever been in a trial and you cried out to Jesus? And it seemed like if he didn't hear. And you wondered, Lord, where are you? Why don't you hear me? Why don't you answer? And we begin to wonder, doesn't God care? But the Bible says that he is there. If we took him along with us, he's there. If we spend time with him in the morning, he's there. This story teaches us something very important. When God is silent, does not mean he's absent. I want you to get that. The storm was raging. Jesus was peacefully sleeping.
no longer bears his
soul. Why? Because he was the God of creation.
He didn't have to
worry.
His
hand. But he was
there.
And when you feel like if God is not hearing my prayers, his silence does not mean he is absent. He's always there. You know, there's a beautiful text in the Bible that I love. Psalm 27:1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
Of
whom shall I be afraid? Some of us are going through life frightened. We don't know what's
going
to happen next. And that fear overwhelms us. We're afraid for our children's future. We're afraid for our job. Maybe we lose it. We're afraid that maybe we don't have enough savings in the bank if something happens. Constantly living in fear. But 1 John 4 tells us that you shouldn't be in fear if you have Jesus. Because his love removes all fear. If you have a relationship with him, you have no need to fear. You know, when I look at the Olympic Games, I love the track and field, the running and the jumping. That's what I like to say. When I look at those athletes running down that track, when do you think they started to practice for that? You think the day before the race they said, let me get some exercise? Maybe 2 weeks or 2 months they began to run. You think that's what they do? They get up every day and for 8 to 10 hours they are exercising. Preparing their bodies for that one race. For years they are doing this. And yet we who are Christians, we know trials will come. We know that the word of God is our strength. And we ignore it. We don't exercise our spiritual
muscles.
And when the trial comes, and it will come, we're not ready for it. Spiritually, we're weak. Many of us turn our backs on God. Sometimes we get angry with him. How could you let this happen? Psalm 18:32 says, it is God who arms me with strength. And makes my way perfect. Perfect doesn't mean no problems. It means when we're going through the problems, he's there with us. Paul tells us in Philippians 4:6-7. Another one of my favorite. He says, don't be anxious. Don't worry. when the problems come,
then
he says, take it to God. Tell him what you need. Give him facts. And then rejoice. Because he's going to give you peace. But I don't think we do that. I think we take our problems to him.
And
we say, Lord, my car is broken. I need a new car. I need money to send my child to school. Lord, I need a job. And there's one person who of those verses that we forget. That after you ask, give God a thanks for what he's
done.
Because you see, there's a name for God that says Jehovah Jireh.
Jehovah Jireh. Oh, can you go to our Jehovah Jireh.
Yes. We find it in the story of Abraham when he was going to sacrifice his son. And remember when he was going to slay his son, God said no. And he showed him a ram in the bush. That's the first place we find the word Jehovah
Jireh.
And it means God sees and provides. You see, God sees your trial before you see it. And he provides the answer before you even know it. But the answer comes in different ways. Now, I know you may say yes, but your son died. But you know something? And I know this may seem strange. But my son's death was the best thing that happened in my life. Because through that, I found Jesus. All the years before, I was a Seventh-day Adventist. I went to church. I paid my tithe. I helped in church. But I didn't know Jesus. I had no daily relationship with him. And when I went through that trial, and I was struggling with him, I found him. And then I shared it with my husband. And he found Jesus. I know I'm going to see my son again. I would have loved him to be here still. In a few days, if he was alive, he would be 37 years old. But you know what? I'll see him again. And I'll see him because I know Jesus now. I have a little adopted granddaughter. She's 6 years old.
That one.
She's really bright. And she asked me one day. She said, Mima. That's what she calls me, Mima. She said, when your son died, did you cry? I said, oh yes, I cried a lot. She said, but God wasn't fair to take your son. 6 years old. And I said, yes, he was.
said,
first, God did not take my son.
Satan
took my son. But you know, at six, it's hard to explain to them that God allowed it. I said, but if God had not allowed my son to die, I wouldn't have my second son. And she said, but Jerry's adopted. That's my second son. He's 27 years old now. And we adopted him when he was 2 years old. And that's another long story. But God was working all the while. Because I had a relationship with him then. And I saw him working. And I'll tell you something about my son, my second son. His mother threw him away on a garbage heap.
Literally.
An Adventist woman found him one Sabbath going to church. Heard a baby crying. There was a big heap of garbage. And she took a stick and began poking in the garbage. And there was this baby. Literally in the garbage. And he ended up in our home. You see, we don't understand why God allows things to happen. But he knows. And we need to trust him. And when the bad things happen, we need to tell him about it. And then we need to thank him for what he's
going to
do. Because my sisters, he's going to do something. He's going to do something amazing in your life. He always does. But you've got to know him. We have to spend time with him every day. So let me end by telling you a story. It's not a true story. But it does. It's a good example of what I want to share. Because it tells us what God expects of us. So there was this man, and he lived in the country area, and he wanted to buy a piece of land to build his house. A house for himself and his wife and his children. And he went from village to village looking for a piece of land. And he finally found a piece that was almost perfect. He wanted a little stream running close to his land. And he wanted it not far from the roadside. But there was a problem with the land. There was a nice house, a nice little house. But in front of the house there was this huge rock. And he thought, why would they leave that rock there? But the man who was selling it said, we couldn't move it, it's too big.
So,
the man bought the house. Because everything else was perfect.
Well,
one night, the man had a dream. And in the dream, God said to the man, I want you to go outside and push on that rock tomorrow morning. And God said, every day I want you to push on that rock.
And the man said,
okay, Lord. So next morning after breakfast, he went outside. And he put his shoulder to the rock and he began to push and push. And all day long he was pushing. Day after day. Month after month. And then one day when he came outside by the rock. And he began to push. The devil came to the man. And the devil said, what are you doing? And the man said, I'm pushing on the rock. And the devil said, why? The man said, because God told me to. And the devil walked around this huge rock. And he said to the man, do you know that for all the time you've been pushing, this rock has not moved? And the man thought, no, it must have moved a little bit. So the man walked around the rock. But the rock hadn't moved. And when he came back to the front, the devil was gone. Because you see, all Satan tries to do is to put a little doubt in your mind. Just a little doubt. And he sent you into total confusion. And the man looked at the rock and he said, I can't believe God told me to do this. All these months I'm pushing on this rock and nothing has happened. I've wasted my time. And so he walked away from the rock. Next morning he came outside, he looked at the rock and he walked away. He said, I'm not pushing on that rock, wasting my time. Then one morning he came out and God was standing next to the rock. And the man went up to the slowly walked up to the rock with his head bent. And God said, what did I ask you to do? And the man said, Lord, you asked me to push on the rock. He said, but Lord, I pushed and the rock didn't move. So I stopped pushing. And God said to him, what did I ask you? And the man said, he asked me to push on the rock. And God said to the man, and the same to each of us today, your job is to push on the rock. My job is to move it. You know, in English, the word push,
P-U-S-H,
means pray until something happens. God says, you pray. Stop studying the word of God. God's
going to
deal with the problems. Sometimes we give up too soon. Sometimes we listen to the wrong voices. God says, I know storms are going to come.
But
you keep praying. Don't give up.
Oh, I do.
Because God can. When you cannot.
Amen.
Amen.
The people of God would say again,
amen.
I'd like to thank you so much to my sister Heather for the sermon today. The sermon lifted our spirit this morning. And I would like to thank you very much, the ladies in Tonga, enjoy the sermon today. And while our spirit being lifted up, we need a choir that lifted up above the sermon today. And we have the choir here this morning. Thank you very much. God and the Bible, I have for can you obey the word to
Mother,
What a blessing, Lord, it's been to spend time with you today. Give you praise, honor, and glory. Thank you for being with us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for working in our lives. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for reminding us how important it is to have you in our boat every day. Lord, prepare us for your soon coming. Be with each person here today, whatever their challenges and trials may be. I pray that you help them remember that Jesus is always there. Thank you again for the wonderful work of the women in the church and for the leadership they have. Bless all our leaders, we pray, our mission president, our mission women's ministries here. Sister Erna, who is not here, please help and heal her today as she rests. Thank you again for all that you have done and will do, Lord. Some of it we don't know what it's going to be, but we're thanking you now for what you will do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.